holding you back, keeping you from doing and being all that God's called you to be. Baggage of hurt. Oh, they hurt me. My childhood was so messed up. I didn't get this, I didn't get that, or I had too much. I don't know what it is, but whatever your baggage is, or I don't got enough education to do what I needed to do. If I would have had this knowledge or that knowledge, whatever your baggage, or I was molested, or I was raped when I was a kid. That's real. Whatever your baggage is, it's still baggage. You got to release it. You got to let it go. And let's unpack this baggage, because it's stuff. See, baggage, it looks compact and it looks like it should, but this is heavy right here because it's layers of baggage. Years. 48 years of baggage. And not only did you go through it, now you're penalizing your kids and all your loved ones around you and making them go through. Some of you been here 50, 60, 70 years. Baggage. It looks normal, like, oh, but look, it's another bag in a bag. Because we compartmentalize everything. Everything. So you think you get rid of one bag, and then you got another. So you look like you're just carrying one bag, but you got at least two bags. Baggage upon baggage. Here's my worry and my fears and my doubts. Here's my unbelief. God don't work for me like that. He worked for everybody else, but not for me. God can't save my marriage. God can't save my kids. God can't.
Come on.
I'm talking about baggage. And you're trying to walk in life and trying to do and move to the next level, but you can't go because you're being held down because you got this baggage. But look at me. It ain't it. It's not over yet. I feel like I'm doing an infomercial. You know, they tell you one more thing. There's more baggage. Looked like it was over, right? Just when you thought you let it go, you got to let something else go. Let go your baby mama and your baby daddy. You got to let it go. Stop trying to hurt and use the kids to get back. It's another bag inside another bag inside another bag inside another bag, and it doesn't stop. And you're carrying all this baggage. All this baggage around with you, and you're wondering why you can't go to the next level.
Help us, Lord. Yes.
Because you got what? What you got?
Yes.
Say it out. What you got?
Yes.
And you can't go to you unless you release the baggage. You know how easy that was?
Yes.
You just gotta let it go and give it to God.
Yes, oh God.
Yes. Hope you're getting it. Packed up. And nowhere to go. See, most of the time when you're packed, you're going somewhere, but you packed up and there's nowhere to go. Help me, God.
Yes.
Thirdly, you got to break through. You got to break through.
Yes.
Breakthrough, see, you can't break through when you're holding all this stuff. Matter of fact, when you're holding all this stuff, you're seeing others break through and you get mad when they're breaking through. I mean, you want to be happy. You're like, praise the Lord. Because you're hurting on the inside. Let it go and give it to God.
Amen.
Matthew 5 and 6 says what? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. What you need, God has. And God, literally, when you let all of this stuff, this baggage go, then God can begin to cause a hunger to come on inside of you. And you can begin to long for him and let him fill that spot.
Yes.
See, that's why I'm so excited about the fasting. Because during this time of fasting, cut the TVs off.
Amen.
Cut the radios off. Fast from criticism.
Yes.
And negative talk. Fast for bad and stupid thinking. What's stupid thinking, Pastor? Thinking that is not aligned with the word of God.
Yeah, yeah.
Isaiah 40 and 31 says, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. See, during this time of fast, just wait on God. It says they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I love around day 5 in the fast, that's when you start getting your second wind. The first 4 days is like a part of you is dying. You're like, Lord, this is not fair. But I love about the fast because I see Christ come out of me more. Because after about the fourth and fifth day, guess what? You don't even have strength to argue anymore. Now, some of you stubborn, it may take you 6 or 7 days, but me, most time, about the third day, I realize this is not functional to do this because I only have so much energy. Some of us wouldn't know what to do if we couldn't argue. That's why you need to fast. Because you realize that, you know what, the little, your talking is taking energy. You start hearing your words in the spirit. They begin to reverberate in your spirit what you're saying to others. Some of us are so callous to what we say to others. God help us. See, it takes a restored and renewed vision to move forward in God. How many knows that? Amen. And so that comes as you sit before the Lord in breakthrough. This means spending time with God so that he can renew and strengthen our lives. See, spending time with God has become a lost art. We talked about prayer. We talked about praise. Just waiting on him. Having the Holy Spirit reveal new things come from waiting on God and allowing him to speak into our spirits. And that comes by making time for him to talk to you. A lot of times God will just show you. You say, well, what do you mean, Pastor? God speaks? Yeah, if you just get quiet. Just get quiet. And after you've told him everything that you're upset about, make sure you stay there 10 to 15 minutes to hear what he's going to say. Because I don't know about you, son. I tell God, Lord, I'm tired. Tired of these kids. Tired of these people, tired of all, and after I be quiet, God said, now let me tell you something about you. I'm tired of your wrong attitude. Amen. I'm tired of your lack of faith. Amen. I'm tired of your doubt and unbelief. Are y'all with me? Let God speak to you. See, a lot of us give God our mind and we get up and we just walk away. Got that done. No, listen to God. Let him speak to you because that's where the transformation comes when God speaks to you. Amen?
Amen.
Let's keep going. Fourthly, increase. Are y'all getting something out of this? Yes. Fourthly, increase. How many? See, this is where you're trying to get. You're trying to get to the break. You want to forgive. You want to release so that you can and get the breakthrough and then get what? Increase. I want you to understand God is not out there trying to hurt you. God really wants to bless you.
Amen.
Let me say that again. God really wants to bless you more than you could ever imagine, more than what you can fathom.
Yes.
But God doesn't violate who he is.
Amen.
He moves in righteousness or being in right standing with him. That means right attitudes, right actions, right heart. They have to be connected together. It's not enough to have the right actions, but have the wrong heart. If you giving stuff an offering and then you complaining about it when you leave here, it ain't working. Are you with me?
Yeah.
On paper, you look like you're doing right. In your heart, you're murmuring, complaining. You have to ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, change my heart. Cause me to see the supernatural power of giving. When you help others, do you understand that you're building and you're sowing into the kingdom of God when you help others? You're sowing into your mercy account. You're sowing into your grace account. You're sowing. Isaiah 42:9 says, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now desire before they spring. I tell you of them. See, at the beginning of the new year is the time for reevaluation, a season of new beginnings. How many times in life have we started a new year without realizing goals we had set before us? Or even taking the time to evaluate why those goals weren't made.
Yes.
See, you,
yes.
During this time, it's time to evaluate who you really are in Christ.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Philippians 3:13-14 says, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. If say forgetting behind. Say forgetting those things which are behind.
Yes.
Reaching forward to those things which are ahead. And pressing toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So I'm just going to real quickly tell you what that is. We cannot live on yesterday's blessing, nor should we dwell on yesterday's failures and disappointments. You got to lay all your burdens to rest. What are we saying? Forget the mess, keep the press, reach for the best. Everybody say that. Forget the mess, keep the press, and reach for the best. You got to forget the mess, because in your mess is a message. And the message can't come forth if you only see it as mess. God makes beautiful things out of the dust. Then you got to keep the press. You got to stay, it used to be a song they sung when I was growing up, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, because your labor is not in vain. You got to keep pressing. You got to keep pressing. You got to keep pressing. You can't stop because you, as that great theologian Michael Jackson says, don't stop till you get enough. Keep on. Don't stop till you get enough. You can't stop till you get enough. And thirdly, don't strive just to be mediocre. Yeah, yeah. Anybody can be mediocre. I tell my kids this all the time. I tell young people this all the time. Strive to be the best. Amen. Strive to be the best. Why? Because you got the greatest leader on the inside of you. It's not, well, that's not my personality. That's not, it's Christ is beyond your personality. Yeah. It's beyond you. What are you going to say to God when you die? Because he says, I put all this wealth on the inside of you, all this greatness, and you just sat on it. One of the richest places on the earth is not in the bank, is not in treasuries. It's in the graveyard. Because so many people have dreams and visions that have never been fulfilled. Because they never stepped out on what God told them to do. See, a couple things you need to know when you're in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Amen. So you're not the same old person that you used to be. So that old person that used to be shy, guess what? You're not that person anymore. I tell people that I used to be shy, they don't believe me. They think I'm lying because guess what? I chose not to be that person anymore. I told her, I chose not to be fearful. I chose not to be scared because I received the fullness of Christ in my life. And Christ is as bold as a lion. So I got to receive his boldness. Amen. 2 Corinthians 4 and 16 says, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Though this outward flesh is dying, my inward man. Because it may get you all depressed about your age. Oh, I'm another year old this year. Oh, Lord, I wonder I had this done by this time. I wish I had this done by that time. I wish I had. Hush that foolishness up. Amen. Start thinking for what you do got done. Amen. Lord, I got strength. Lord, I got a right mind. There's some folk, you need to go visit a hospital and visit a terminal ward and see. There's some folk right there don't even know who they are. Don't know what time it is. And you sit here, got all your activity of your limbs, a healthy body, crying about what you don't have. God, help us to be thankful. Help us, God. You've given us so much. Last scripture, 1 Kings. Last scripture for the new year. And then we're going to get on our faces and pray. Because God is here, amen? And God wants to visit you. And we want to look at Elisha. Now, Elisha was a servant of, was a prophet in the Old Testament, and he was the servant of Elijah. And many are familiar that Elisha begged his servant or prophet to have a double portion of his anointing, and he received it. Elijah was famous for saying, if you see me when I go to meet the master, I'm paraphrasing, when you see me when I go up, you'll get the same anointing that I have. So you have to understand, this is legend, it's understood, so you can understand the passage of the scripture. Because I'm talking about increase and how God wants to increase you. Amen? Amen? So we're talking about what? Increase and how God wants to?
Increase.
Let's say it one more time. We're talking about?
Increase.
And how God wants to?
Increase.
Okay, one more time. We're talking about? Increase and how God wants to increase a me. Come on, one more time. We're talking about increase and how God wants to increase me. Make it personal. Amen. Nothing selfish about that. God is concerned about you. So you see, we're looking at the passage, and you can go back and read the whole chapter. It's 2 Kings. That's the title. 2 Kings, chapter 13, verses 14 through 20. 2 Kings. Chapter 13, verses 14 through 20. Now, when Elisha had fallen sick with illness of which he was to die, Joash, king of Israel, now notice, understand, the prophet at that time was like the voice of God. Yeah. Now we're under grace, so we don't have to go through a prophet. We can come right into the holies of holies and hear God for ourselves. And at the time, guess what? The prophet was sick. I really believe right now that the church of God is sick right now. Amen. But there's always a remnant in the midst of the church that's going to rise up and stand. Amen? Yes. Joash, the king of Israel, went down to him and wept before him, crying, my father, the chariots of Israel and his horsemen. And Elisha said to him, take a bow. Talk about a bow and arrow. Take a bow and arrow. So he took the bow and arrows. And then he said to the king of Israel, draw the bow. So he drew the bow back. And he drew it. And Elisha said, laid his hands on the king's hand. So Elisha, you have this king here who is hopeless. And he puts his hand on him. It's much like God puts his hand on us. And he draws his bow. And he lets it go. I really believe that the voice of God becomes sick in our lives when we put other things before him. God wants first things first. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be added. Let's keep reading. 17th verse. And he said, open the window eastward. And he opened it. And then Elijah said, shoot. And he shot the arrow. Ah, feeling strong, right? Feeling hopeless at first, but oh man, he shot the arrow with the help of God's help, the prophet of God, who's on his sickbed. And he said to the king of Israel, strike the ground with him. And he struck the ground three times. So the prophet gave him a word, said, now, after you shot the arrow, now take the arrows that you have left and strike the ground. And this is what he did. He took the arrow and he struck it three times. One, two, three. And he stopped. He stopped. That could be all right. It showed that he just wanted just enough. Because if I told you right now, strike the thing that's in your life that's keeping you down, guess what? I want you, bam, to tell me, do I be bam, 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 bam. Are y'all with me? So then the man of God, Elisha, was angry with him. I'm talking about increase. Increase is a choice, you all. Some of us are all right with just enough. Just enough. When God's giving you more. I'm not talking about being greedy. I'm talking about you're not living up to the potential that God has for you. Then the man, right, that abundant life. He says, I came that you may have life and life more abundantly. Then the man of God, and I'm talking about joy. I'm talking about peace. I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about having increase in your life in every area and your soul and your being. Then the man of God was angry with him and said, you should have struck five or six times. Then you would have struck down Syria. You would have tore down your enemy. Amen. That stronghold would have broken if you would have attacked it. But until you had made an end of it. But now you will strike down Syria only three times. And then the prophet Elisha died and they buried him. See, I don't think the story has to end like that. I think you determine the end of the story. We're in the New Testament for grace. We can learn from our brother's mistake. The Bible says that the Old Testament is there to show us examples of what we and how we should conduct ourselves. Amen? As we go into this new year, in this new time of grace and mercy and love, let's purpose in our heart, we're going to take every opportunity for increase. Amen. We're not going to settle. Turn to somebody and say, I'm not going to settle. I want you to do this right now. We got 4 minutes left. I want you to take the time to write down on that sheet of paper. Does everybody have a sheet of paper? What you need to throw away. What you need to die. And here's the casket. We're going to have a burial service. wrong attitudes, whatever you need to do. Let me get a sheet. Let me write some stuff down. Hallelujah. She got me one. Get a sheet. Wrong attitudes, whatever it may be. Take one back. Hallelujah. Write it down. We're going to end it right now. We're not taking this in 2016. And then after that, we're going to sow a supernatural seed. We're going to believe God that he's going to meet us as we end well. Amen? Hallelujah. So go ahead. We're going to release and we're going to give. Everybody say, forgive.
Forgive.
Amen. Let me tell you something. When you forgive yourself, you can give a little bit more. And then you can get rid of all of this baggage. All of these compartments that were on the ground. God has a way of taking each and every one and putting them back in order. And making it something beautiful to look at. Doesn't look beautiful when it's all on the ground spread out. But he has a way of putting it all back together. That's real special. Go ahead and write it down. Write it down. We're going to cast our cares on him tonight. Wrong attitudes, wrong mindsets, unforgiveness of family and friends. If you've been lonely, we're going to leave the loneliness in 2016. If you've been depressed, we're going to just be honest. We're going to leave depression in 2016. Whatever that thing is, we're not taking it in 2017. Anger, fear, doubt, unbelief, whatever it is, we're leaving it. We're leaving it. Despair, hopelessness, we're leaving it. Lust, perversion, we're leaving it. Whatever that thing is, greed, we're leaving it. Lay it down. Low self-esteem, we're leaving it. We're going to be the people that God's ordained us to be. This is your year for forgiveness, for release, for breakthrough, and increase. 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 I want you to get in your spirits. This is your year. Let's get on our faces. Come on. Father, we just thank you right now. God, we honor you for your presence, and we decide today that we're not taking this with us. But God, right now, just go ahead and put your prayers to God. Just say your prayer to him. And I'm going to pray. You can pray over me or loud. Just pray. Just release. God, we just thank you, God, for another year. And we just say, God, we're with our families right now and friends, and we're praying in the new year, God. We say, God, some are getting high on spirits and weed and drugs and all that, God. But, God, we choose to be with you of sober mind and sober body, and we don't want a hangover, we want a carryover. God, a carryover of grace, a carryover of mercy, a carryover of peace over our family, Lord, a carryover of blessing over our lineage, God, that each and every one will be blessed in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that hearts and minds, God, will be renewed this year, God. And God, the abundant life that you promised each and every one of us will come forth in us in the name of Jesus. God, we praise you and we honor you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name. Come on, in Jesus' name. Come on, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Give God some praise. Hallelujah. Come bury your problem. Come on, come bury your problem. Come bring it down. Bury it in the, come bury your problem. Throw it in the casket. Or you don't have to put your name on it. Just leave it there. Amen? Because it don't got your name. That's not who you are. That's not who you are. Notice I didn't say put your name on your paper because that's not you. That's not who you are. Leave it in there. Let it go. Say, I let it go. I'm not keeping this for this new year. 2017. I forgive. Come on, I forgive. I forgave. I forgive. I forgave. I release. I'm releasing. I release. And I'm releasing. I'm breaking through. And I am a breakthrough. I'm breaking through. And I am a breakthrough. I receive increase. I receive increase. And I'm increasing others. I receive increase. And I'm increasing others. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. It's not over. We got time to give back to God. It's time to give back to God. Hallelujah. Supernatural seed. Honey, you know, we already discussed what God told us to give. Hallelujah. Make it hurt. Come on, supernatural. Supernatural. I realize as a leader, if I don't sow supernatural, I can't expect anybody else to sow supernatural. Amen. And I'm telling you, God is faithful. God is faithful. I want you to understand, I thought about when I tell this story of what really happened to us when we were planting this church and God spoke to us to plant this church. And just how always God always followed with blessings with every word that he gave us. And when we received that the first seed we sowed into this church, God spoke to a young lady in Italy that we had ministered to when she was a teenager. And she had turned 21. And she called us from Italy. She was raised in the States and was married to her husband in the military and said, "You all have been in my heart. I've been praying for you." And again, this is 9 years ago when God has spoke to us, okay, now's the time. Start the church. Yeah. And this young girl that we had ran away from home had tried a troubled life, and we were at Trinity Chapel. My wife and I took her in and helped get her parents counseled and helped bring them together so she could stop running away, and called us out the blue. She was in, 21, 22. "Howard and Tekla, I just so appreciate you all. I'm thankful for what you've done in my life, and I just want to do something for you because you've been on my heart. I can't stop. Thank you. What do y'all get?" We told her we're getting ready to start a church, and I just got to, she said, "Well, I'm going to send you something." She got an address. I thought she was going to send us, like a card and maybe $10 or $20. But the young lady sent $10,000. And I brag on God in this because she sent it to Tekla and I and says, "I'm blessing Howard and Tekla." Yeah. We in turn blessed the church with it. Yeah. And it was in our budget, not so that we can have a slush fund for the 501c3. So this church started with supernatural giving. And it's been like that ever since. Yeah. Every year, different ones have been blessed. We've been blessed to go back and sow. So when I talk about giving, I really believe this thing. It's not a plaything to me. It's something we live. It's something we believe. And I believe that God honors supernatural giving. Amen? And so I thought about when I tell the story, I said, I don't know if I make it clear. I said, yeah, we said that was the first 10,000 seed, but that was the first 10,000 seed that my wife and I sowed. And at the time, when we were starting the church, we had our own personal needs. Because the God told us to stop working. Told me to tell her to get off her job. Told me to stop selling real estate. You know me, didn't I do well when I was in real estate? I did very well. I'm doing 4 or 5 houses a month, and I was doing commercial real estate, making 10% on everything that I sold. The minimum of $10,000 per closing. So I understand. So when God was telling me, I'm like, okay, Lord, I got a family. Lord, what are you going to do? But he's been faithful ever since. And then God helped us to get a group. I'm just telling you, then I'm looking as we sowed those, and I feel like God honors that seed because right shortly after we sowed that seed, got our 501c3. What, our 501c3 came through what, in a month? Yeah. No, was it a week? It's 2 weeks. The consultants that we worked with said, we ain't never seen nothing like that. Yeah. It went through in 2 weeks. Matter of fact, they called us and said, what did y'all do? We said, we just used your program. So that never happens. Not only did that happen, I mean, God just kept moving supernatural. Then God opened up doors with the Southern Baptist where we were able to get a grant for 5 years to pay our salaries. So I'd have to beg you for money for the first 5 years because guess what? God raised some people that don't look like you. Many of them were white, Caucasian, sold into this ministry and sold into the vision that we laid out and said, we see this happening in Acworth, Kennesaw.
That's right.
But I really believe all of it started with the $10,000 seed.
Yes, that's true.
God opens up doors that no man can close. It didn't stop there. Then God moves on a couple, the Lyles, in Kennesaw, Georgia, at the Kennesaw Grand. Because we were being at where, honey? Before then.
Wow.
What? Say it loud.
Wildwood Baptist
Church. We're meeting there, and we're meeting there at 2 o'clock in the evening. The Holy Spirit, after we negotiated a deal that Wildwood Baptist said, you don't need to be there. I was like, Lord, well, how do you have to negotiate? He said, this is just a warm-up for your faith. Tell the church that Sunday, right? Told you to come off your job, told me to come off my job, and tell the church that Sunday, we're going to have another building.
Come on. Yes.
My wife, how are we going to do it if we don't have jobs? Because we were paying, every time I was giving, we were main one giving. I don't know. Make a long story short, there's a church at the Kennesaw Grand. That's why you got to hear God and obey God. The same Sunday that God spoke to me to do this, and come before the church was the same Sunday that church there had that last Sunday there.
Yes, that's right.
And those owners began to pray and fast for a new church to be in there. That same Sunday morning, I got up and said, we need to pray and fast for a building.
Amen.
Our hearts met on Wednesday. And a couple that I'd never seen before, that didn't look anything like me. They're a Caucasian couple. I just came off the street and met them. And they hand me the keys to their building and says, God told us we're supposed to give it to you.
Yes.
And it didn't stop there. It says, you know what? But here's the catch. Was it 8 years, 7 years? We were there for 8 years. Yes. And 7 of those years were rent free.
Yes.
That's unheard of. God spoke to us that we were going to do it. God spoke to us that he was going to give us a building rent free. And the consultants laughed at me and said, God doesn't do that type of stuff anymore. We were at the Grand. You know why I wanted to make sure we took care of everything? Because they said, the only thing is, Pastor Howard, he said, oh, you can have the keys. I said, well, I still got to pray about it. He said, you can pray about it, but we're fasting. And God brought you in our direction. We said, the first church that comes, you're the first church. I said, well, I still got to pray and fast. They said, well, just keep the keys while you pray and fast. And said, we're going to show you around. So, but here's the catch. You can't, this is our tithe to your ministry. This is our business, and we're believers, and we sow our business on Sundays back to churches.
Yeah.
See, giving hearts link up with what? Giving hearts. And I really believe that God set that up and set us up. And so when I talk about giving and the importance of giving and how God moves and supernatural giving, this is not a game to me. This is not a way to get rich. I'm talking about how to be blessed in God. It's greater than riches when you have your mind and your soul and your being and you have the good feel of helping somebody.
Amen.
Some of you were there one Sunday when I shared, and I'm wrapping up. We're going to take the offering. I'm just trying to get you in the mindset of supernatural. Everybody say supernatural.
Supernatural.
This happened recently. I was going to the grocery store. Low money because it was Christmas. I mean, right 2 weeks before Christmas. And I think we had to delay my check that week, right? So I was low, and I saw this Latino lady there. And she was crying at the Kroger's on Giles. And she was out there, and she was like, you know, she had a sign. She couldn't speak English, need food. And I saw her, and I was going, you know, it was Saturday night. I had Sunday the next day. I was like, I got to get in here, get out. I don't like to leave the house on Sunday, Saturday night. I like to lock in, prepare. I don't like to open myself to all type of spirits. I try to be fresh and focused. So if something we need for us, I'll run in and get out. I saw this lady, and I was like, Lord, I got to go. I got to go. Lord, I don't have time. The Holy Spirit said, stop, turn around, and go back to her. And she just started, when I turned around, she already had a tear on her. She just started weeping. Need food, need food. And our little daughter was there, and it was raining outside. And so she was in the rain. She wasn't under the covering. She was near the covering, but she was getting wet with the sign. And so I went in there. I said, ma'am, I'm going to help you. I'm going to help you. I'm going to get some food for you. She said, oh, thank you. She just grabbed me and just start crying. And then a guy that looked like Santa Claus, who actually is a Santa Claus impersonator, he does it for a living, who's a Christian, he comes up beside me and says, I'm going to help you. God told me I'm supposed to help you. Because at the time, I was like, look, I don't have that much money. All I can do is maybe 20 bucks. And So he said, I'm going to help you. He walks up beside me. He says, we're going to split it together. I said, okay, we can do that. So we go shopping, and his wife sees him with me, and we're getting stuff in the basket. She's like, why are you in that man's basket? My basket's over here. Because he had told his wife, you know how we husbands do. We forget to tell our wives what we're doing. So he shopping. He says, no, I'm helping this man out. We're going to help the lady out front. And so we go, and we're going this right at the cross, shopping at the store. And I'm like, man, I got to get back. I got to finish the word. I got to try to. But we're doing this, but we're having a good time. He told me what he was doing, and then now he's just. I just got a job. I got blessed. I was at the Presbyterian church playing Santa Claus, so I can use some of that to bless them. And you know, he's going through all sharing when I was sharing who I am and telling them about our church. And didn't tell them I was the pastor, just tell them about our church. Make a long story short, we get in line. It's not over yet. Get in line. And I see another lady that's in line. And she goes in line and she gets... She keeps smiling at me while she's shopping. I found out where the lady knew me from. She knew me from BJ's because my wife knows I talked to everybody. And she had her kids. And she was getting, because when I didn't find out until a week later who she was, but she's heard it and she's shopping for the lady too. So we're getting cereal, getting stuff. She's like, because I want cereal, I want milk. You know, she kept telling me what she wanted. And we took it to the lady and we gave it to her. And she just began to weep, and we grabbed her. And again, the other black lady was also got the stuff. We grabbed her and said, no, you think you blessed us? We're blessing you. No, you're blessing us. Amen. This was to bring the goodness out of us. Yeah. You're not worthless. You're not helpless. Yeah. There's greatness in you. And you just changed my heart and my life today. Amen. And so this is how God returns us. So we prayed with her. She went and took all the stuff. Prayed. We walked into her car and everything. So we had to go shopping for ourselves. We went back to shop. When we got in line, guy that looked like Santa Claus, I can't remember, Bill, his name was Bill. He looked white and, you know, had the white hair and everything. And he got in line. He was talking to somebody about the Lord. Meanwhile, I'm in line after him, talking to his wife. I'm praying for her because I gave her a testimony. My wife was healed from cancer and praying with her. He's talking to the people in front of him. The people in front of him who are not believers just wants to pay for his meal. I mean, all his stuff, his groceries. When I finish praying, he turns to me and says, they paid for my groceries, so God's telling me I'm supposed to pay for your groceries. Amen. Are you with me? Yeah. What I'm saying is, God honors giving. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave. Every time you give, you see supernatural. Get that in your spirit.
Entire life. As I just think about everything that I've gone through, overcame, my kids, just literally my entire life, my kids have been a testimony. God has healed them, restored them from even birth. Recently, I had a situation where my son got really ill and he had to have a lot of x-rays and ultrasound, just different things done. They couldn't figure out what was going on with him. And he ended up having like swollen lymph nodes in his stomach that really affected his health. And
God help us.
I remember we went through all the testing and a year later, this year, probably a few months ago, I got a bill in the mail and I'm like, this wasn't covered. And so it was like $2,400. And I'm like, not paying this. So I'm like, oh Lord, like why would they just send me a bill for $2,400 from a year ago? And I was like, well, I don't have this money to pay right now, so let me call them, let them know I'm not gonna pay it right now. I'll pay a little bit each month. So I called them. I said, yeah, you know, I need to set up payment arrangements. I could pay it in about 6 months. And they were like, why can't you pay it all right now? And I said, because I don't have it to pay. So I called them up, I told them that. So when I got ready to make the first month payment, I wanted to do auto draft. So I called them back up and I was on the phone for at least 45 minutes. So I was already upset about that. And so by the time the lady came back to the phone, she was like, Ms. Drakeford, give me the number again. I gave her the number again. And she was like, well, there's no bill for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
So $2,400, we didn't even have to pay the payment arrangements, and it was clear. So I definitely thank God for that. And then
debt cancellation.
Yes, yes. A few weeks ago, there was a glitch with our banking system where all of a sudden, like a week and a half before bills were due, mortgage, car notes, just different payments, about nine things came out of my account before it even should have. We have everything set up on automatic draft. So I called the bank and literally probably about $3,000 was all coming out at once. And it was bills that shouldn't even been coming out. So I called them and I'm like, this is an issue. You guys have to fix this before my account go into overdraft. So then God was like, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. So we were down to like finding money in jackets and stuff. And we're like, look, analyzing everything, trying to cancel everything else from coming out. Long story short, I had $20 on me, and it was like 2 days before everything was going to get fixed, and I didn't want anything else to come out the account. And I was going to get some gas, and a guy was standing in the road, and he almost got hit. And I was like, what is going on with this guy? So then he started knocking like at my window, and I'm like, yes. And he was like, hey, someone stole something out of his car. I can't remember what it was, but he needed $17 to get it repaired, and that's all he was short, and somebody was on the way to try to fix it, and I don't remember exactly what it was. And so I was like, give me a few minutes. So I didn't have any gas, and I was all the way in Canton at work. So I was like, well, Lord, I'm gonna trust that he's telling me the truth. And I was like, sir, I'm gonna believe you that this is what you need. I don't have it to give it to you, but if this is what you need, I'm gonna give it to you. So he started talking about God. And he said the person that almost hit him, he had gave the guy gave him like $40 to take care of his need. And he said, God bless you. And he said, F your God. Because you said that, I'm taking my money back, and then I almost hit him. So that's what I witnessed when I was coming up, him almost getting hit. So I gave him the money, and I think I had like, I think I put like $5 in account because I found like another dollar around the car, and then I made it home. My husband, he had like $40 from somewhere. I don't know where he got it. But so he got me more gas, whatever. And within the next day, I got a check for like $784. I got another check in the mail for it was like $56. Like literally checks just started coming in the mail. I got something said that, you know how like a company may get sued, and it was some telephone company that called me that should have called me on my cell phone. And so they sent a suit, probably like a letter talking about it. I remember, Pastor, you said when Cobb EMC one time, they did that whole thing. And
that
I was
lawsuit.
Like, yeah, I said, don't nobody got time for that. I'm not filling that out. So I didn't do it. And Pastor was like, y'all should have did it because I got my check. And so they were praising God. So this time I did it. This was like a year ago. That check came in the mail and literally everything just started falling in place. And I'm God is just amazing. And I would say you guys trust God. And even when you don't believe, or even when you don't have, even when you have little faith, trust God, know that he's going to take care of it. I'm a very strategic thinker and I like to handle things. But now I just say, you know, God, I'm not going to worry about it. I just give it all to you and you work it out. So my testimony.
Amen. And you've been blessed, right? You're what is your position at Target? Yeah, you've been blessed for your
That's
job.
Another thing. I'm a district resource for Target. I'm an executive with the company. I've been there almost 20 years. But the job that I have, I became an executive with the company when I was 19. Also, I didn't have any of the credentials. Most people that have my position has master's or multiple degrees. I don't have one. I'm going back to school to finish school right now, one semester at a time. So I have literally nine classes left, and I probably do like two each semester. But I know that God put me in this position.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else has a testimony? Come on, Victoria. Yes, ma'am.
So, I went to Kaufman Mall to do after Christmas shopping, and I bought two bags. So this guy and his wife just grasped my arm, like, can you buy me a piece of food? I was like, okay. I was like, it's like everybody was just ignoring them. I knew something was wrong, the way they were dressed, like, something's not right. So he's like, whatever you can afford. I said, I'll pay for it. And I got them Chick-fil-A, and he thanked me after that. He said, you have a blessed new year. And I was like, okay. It go back to you said, like, you can't ignore people because people are hurting out there.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. I love to hear things where we help people because that's what Christ is. Amen. Anybody else have any testimonies? Go ahead, Lee.
So I just want to talk about how God has been blessing me with my education from just school, from being able to do dual enrollment from my junior year and getting all these college classes done, from taking all these tests for college, from the SAT and the ACT. God has allowed me to excel on both of them to get accepted into multiple colleges. And applying to colleges isn't hard, but it's time consuming. So me and my mom have been working on those. And so far I've gotten into.
And that.
And so far I've gotten into Valdosta State, KSU, Georgia State, Hampton, and Georgia College. So I'm just waiting on the rest of the colleges that I applied to see which ones I got into. But yeah, God's just been faithful for me with my education, and I hope to and continue to for him to keep helping me with this in any way possible.
Will. Amen. Anyone else got a testimony? Come on. Come on.
Listening to Latoya about, you know, things come out your account when you're not supposed to be coming out, and you know, a lot of times it's the enemy, you know. And so with us, with my husband just having foot surgery, you know, and so on and so forth. So we had I remember telling you guys about, we had did a seminar for the Fulton County. It was 2 days. And then before we left, they had filled out another contract for us to do another one. You know, and I was testifying, the enemy said, you shouldn't say anything. It's not final. But I remember Pastor saying, you know, just say it. And so the minute I said it, got back, and it was just, you know, all down here from there. And so I did like the toy. I was like, you know what? I'm not going to worry about it. I'm just going to let it go. And then, you know, things start happening, you know. The car wanted to act up, and we had a few other things that happened. And, you know, and the one thing I had told you guys that I said, I know what I needed to have by the end of the year, you know, to carry over to 2017, and it was there. And the enemy tried to suck it out, but I kept saying, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And so, you know, the money's still in our account. Bills are paid. They turned up the cell phone. We woke up, I was like, why is the cell phone off? So my husband was like, you know, I usually get upset. I'm like Teclan, I like to have everything. I worry. And that's always been me. I lose sleep. Leroy sleeps. He was like, oh, I'm just going to sleep. And I'm like laying up with the calculator trying to punch numbers later. But long story short, I was driving home from the school. I went to the school to pick up something for taxes, and my phone rung. It did a funny ring, and my email popped up, and it was, her name is Teresa Bell, Miss Bell. And she said, hey, Miss London, I know we've been canceled, but we are ready to cut it. The check has been cut, and we mailed it today.
Glory to God.
And I said, well, I need to drive out to the school so I can get this check out of mailbox, but it came through. All they needed was the dates. The check has already been cut, and it has been mailed. I'm quite sure it's in the mailbox at the school, but I was going to get it today, but I said, you know what? I know it's there. But, you know, I'm like, God, he is faithful. And we always talk about these creeds. I always keep saying check in the mail. That's my kids will tell you, I always say there's a check in the mail. It's always a check in the mail. But I just thank God that it did come through. And I wasn't even, I just gave it to God and let it go. But it's a nice psalm, and I'm just so thankful and so happy. Happy New Year.
Amen. Give God some praise. Go ahead. You got a testimony? Go ahead, sweetie.
Yes. Well, you know, God has just continually been providing for us. And so I just thank God for his provision. Because our favorite quote is around the house, even is where he leads, he feeds, and where he guides, he provides. And the devil can never take away your purpose or your calling. But if he can make you lose confidence while you're doing his purpose and his calling, he'll try to do that. But even in the provision, God has been faithful in providing for us. And as you know, God came through with our health insurance because things are changing over. And at one point, we're thinking we're going to have to pay this exorbitant amount, like $1,400 to or $1,200 for our insurance for, you know, just a couple of us on it. And God came through where we got a great insurance plan because our Humana left Georgia. So we were able to get a great plan where we only pay $120 a month. But what we found out shortly after, yes, for the family. So we're like, hallelujah. We found out shortly after that all of the Wellstar, Kennestone, any of the hospitals around us would not be hospitals we can go to. We had to go out to Canton or Cartersville or somewhere. We're like, okay, Lord, we'll do that. But man, you know, all of our network was Wellstar. Soon as we said that we just said, well, God, where you lead, you feed, where you guide, you provide. The next day,
we committed to you.
The letter came through from Wellstar saying that they've decided to change their policy and they'll accept the type of plan that we got and all the plans that went through this certain exchange because they did not want to lose the customers. They value the customer or the patients that have been in that system and in that network.
Amen.
So we just praise God because even in the little things, God is so faithful. And if we just press in and trust him, he cares about the very littlest of things as we are faithful to just continually lean on him. So I just want to praise God with that because that
also
was just so
recent.
Also,
want to give a test. Amen. Give God some praise.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Just even in how he's tuition, how God's been faithful.
Yes.
Every session, every time that bill come, we've been able to pay it.
Yes.
And that's just a blessing. So I just want to give God that you can go to school debt-free.
Yes.
If you shop and believe God and you don't have to get loans, amen. And you can trust God, and God's just been so faithful. We've, you know, God opens up. I look and I taught 8 times last week. I'm going to teach 7 times this week. They canceled all my classes, canceled her classes, and then 8 more places opened up where we could get twice as much what we normally make.
Yes.
And so it's just funny how. That's why you just can't be moved by what you see. I don't believe that the devil can take anything from you.
Yes.
What God does, he'll shut one door and open up another one.
Yes, he will.
I remember when we announced that the house was under contract for Richard, and then it fell out of contract right afterwards. So I said, well, you shouldn't have said it. No, we should have said it. God had a plan. God was going to say, are you going to trust me? Do you understand? We had 3 contracts this week on his house.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Sometimes God has another route.
Yes.
And God wants to see, are you going to praise him as you go through?
Yes.
Because it's not always what he does. See, again, say this,
the enemy
cannot take anything
from me
that God has for me. And I really believe this, the client that we may have had for that house may have been not the one that would have given us the most difficulty. Whatever God has, he'll bring that to you. All you got to do is stand in faith. As soon as we declare something, I'm telling you, the enemy comes and attack, but he can't have what God has for you.
Yes.
You keep standing strong for God. You keep speaking the word. And I'm telling you, God will meet you every step of the way. He's so much bigger than the enemy.
Yes.
Amen. And I just pray you get in your head that he wants to bless you more than you want to be blessed.
Amen.
When you get that in your mind, you won't be moved by anything that you see, young people. So, love you all. We're going to get ready. Yes, ma'am, you got to tell.
Is breakfast served in a few moments?
Of course. I'm not going to delay you because I'm ready to serve you. Okay. But I have a testimony of faith.
Yeah. Put the mic to your mouth.
Beyond you all in age and life challenges. But starting the end of last year, our family had some severe challenges. Hurry up, we had a wedding plan. We had my husband's health attacked. Shortly thereafter, we had a virus in the house. Rhonda never recovered, and from there, she was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. My mother was ailing, and I had already planned my summer to go to North Carolina because nobody could take care of my mom but me. So I thought, and it was to go take care of my mom. But the way God's faith worked in this, the way my faith worked, it was a challenge. Do you believe? Well, Lord, how do you let this person have this serious disease? I mean, I'm going over the things that she's done so right, and then he come back, can you trust me? So I will say for 2016, you know, sometimes I'm in tears thinking of how my whole structure and my faith was shattered, yet it was renewed, continuously being renewed. So at this stage, I can say, you know, as long as you live, there will be challenges, but they're always so different. You know, it's like, wow, what is this? I've never seen, I never thought that I could hurt or that I could see or that I could experience. And in the end, it's his love and his saving grace and your commitment to him. So I've said this year for me, 2017, I want to get more of him. I want to give more of myself, because we've already been through the stages of the tuition, passing tests, and getting here, getting there, the marriages, the babies, the this, the that, the other, the children getting housing, and what are you, you know, all these things. But then, in the end, or at some stage of life, you don't have to get to be as old as we are, but you need a relationship with God so you will have something in the bank. Because something can hit you so hard and there'll be nothing that you can bank on but your faith and trust. And he's coming back repeatedly reminding, well, do you trust me? And it's all right. Well, how can this be all right, you know? It's all right, and it's going to be all right.
Amen.
So I would say, you know, get as much as you can of God. You will need him. And value your faith and increase it day by day.
Amen. Give God some praise. So, Father, we just thank you, Lord, and we bless the food that we're about to receive. We pray that it will be nourishing for our bodies, God. And, Lord, we thank you for the spiritual food that we've received. Let it be nourishing for our bodies. Let our fellowship be sweet with one another. In Jesus' name.
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 Amen and amen.